1, 2, 3, 4.
This is Hunt Sales, legendary drummer, songwriter, producer, band leader, and father. Hunt is known for recording one of the most iconic and imitated drum grooves in rock and roll history for the song Lust for Life by Iggy Pop. Chances are, if you found yourself here, you are a Hunt fan, so you know the story. Hunt and his brother Tony's dad was Soupy Sales, who was a world-famous comedian, actor, radio personality in the 1960s and 70s. As young boys, they were exposed to many genius entertainers. These included titans of the big band world, which made a huge impact on the Sales brothers. At only 11 years old, Hunt got his first record deal and his musician's union card. He's never looked back since. Heavily influenced by big band players, Hunt is the product of both private instruction and self-taught ear training. While already pro, he still wanted to sharpen his skills in between bands, so he sought out many elite drummers. These included Colin Bailey, Freddie Gruber, and even getting a note of support from Dennis Wilson of the Beach Boys. Now armed with more discipline and technique, it was actually Hunt's strong yearning for a more primal, purposely less polished approach that trademarked his legendary sound. As a young and hungry drummer, Hunt consistently jumped onto jam nights and did session work from Detroit to New York to Vegas to LA to Austin to Germany and anywhere there was action around the globe. If honing your skills jamming with A-listers every night in various clubs as a teenager, recording and touring for established rock stars, and taking lessons from your drum heroes, all while growing up in a broken home, wasn't enough to force you to grow up, how about sharing a backstage dressing room with your brother and a diving horse? He's done that too. One of many things we have in common in our experiences was going to drummer showcases or master classes and finding that, after a while, all of the intricate shredding, blazing ostinatos, 64th note triplets with your right hand while playing a reverse clave with your left foot, it all started sounding the same. There was no heart, no passion, no emotion. All these modern drummer cover session guys blended together after a while. It just became a blur. I think that comes from not only being connected to the music on a heavier emotional level, which is usually connected to pain or trauma of some kind, and that does include love. It's also a drummers who write songs and play other instruments thing. These are orchestrators, arrangers, drummers with a vision, not just needing the spotlight all the time. Hunt has performed with the Sales Brothers, Todd Rundgren, Paris, Ray Manzarek, Iggy Pop, David Bowie, Tin Machine, and way too many more to mention. Currently, he's rocking in his own band called the Hunt Sales Memorial. Please reach out and support them. This is a real rock and soul from the heart kind of music. check them out on the old interweb, and see them live as soon as we are all let out of our cages. Just a heads up, this interview is quite long, so I broke it up into two parts. You name it, we talked about it. Actually, he talks about it. Thank God. Enjoy.
Hello?
Hey there, Hunt. This is Burke again.
Hey, Burke. I tried to call you back, but you're no idea, and it doesn't hook up to any phone number, so whatever, there you are. I was in this store up the block, and it would have cut out anyways, so.
No worries. Thanks for your patience on my technical crap. I was trying to get all fancy with a phone app when I should have just done it old school right through my computer, but
I like people go, well, it's got to be in the studio. It's got to be tape. And that's the only way. I like Pro Tools and all that stuff. It's just the learning curve with the computers. I let someone, there's a million engineers that can press buttons and do what I tell them to do. Yep. You know what I mean? I end up telling them where to do the edits anyways. A lot of times they don't know. I don't know if it's from being a drummer or from, I used to do a lot of editing of tape back in the day. I was really good with that. So what's going on with yourself? You were in a car accident or something? Is that what the deal is?
I think you've played with Hart in years past. So Roger Fisher brought me on to be in his new Hart band, because in Seattle there's like 20 Hart cover bands, and he's finally putting together his own thing because he wrote a lot of the stuff. And
who was he, a guitar player or what?
Yeah, he was the lead guy who left, towards the end of their heyday to on stage.
I know of Hart. Yeah. I was in a band this family had called Paris. Bob Wilk. And I remember they had just really broke with their first hit record, and we were out doing these package shows in the Midwest, and that was my first, this had to be, what is it, 74?
Yeah.
Something like that. 74, 75, whatever, it was before Iggy. And I remember doing a couple shows with Hart, and he probably would have been the guy that was with them then.
Yeah.
Back in, yeah.
He had the double neck, the double neck guitar. That guy.
Yeah. I don't remember that much detail, but I just remember the two chicks looked really hot, and they sounded and they sounded great, and we were in fucking Boise, Idaho, or Cleveland somewhere, and it was them and us and Aria Speedwagon or some bullshit.
Wow.
And we were playing theaters, you know, like 2,000 seat theaters, shit like that.
Yeah.
And I remember doing a couple gigs with the Baker Gurvitz Army, Ginger Baker and the Gurvitz Brothers, you know, and that was wild.
I had a crash a couple years ago. I play with Duff too, and it changed everything. I was actually paralyzed for 3 days. Never thought I'd play drums again. I had to learn to walk. I'm actually back on the kit, and I'm able to teach. I have a little school at my house.
Good.
So I'm at about maybe 70% back to where I was, you know, and what I'm really after is the quick twitch, you know, foot stuff, because it's a lot of nerve damage. It's because it's a spinal cord, C6.
Yeah. Spinal cord. But you're walking? You're able to walk?
Yeah. But I used to run about 10 miles a day, and I used to run before and after shows. I was just really high energy. And that's a life change.
Yeah, I remember my brother was in a horrific car accident. Where he was in a coma for about 3 weeks, two and a half, 3 weeks. And man, it was, then he came to, and he didn't know who anyone was. He didn't know who I was. It was scary, man. And then eventually he came back from it. But it was bad, man. But it's amazing. I mean, even the doctors, when they were 8 to 16 hours of surgery, because he had a 57 Chevy and he fucking hydroplaned. It was raining and he was fucked up and ran into a fucking telephone pole like 60, 70 miles an hour. And, you know, those telephone poles, they ain't moving at all.
I saw one of his interviews, and he said he had a stick shift through his chest.
Yeah, one of the three on the tree, as they call it. Yeah, that went through his chest, and it was just, I had to go. I remember he was living above me in this duplex, and I had to go down to get the keys. He was in the hospital, but it was an old lady. I had to go down where they had towed the fucking car and get the keys out of it because his house keys were on there. And, man, that the back seat was where the front seat is. I mean, that car was just so fucked up. Yeah. I just remember how fucked up he was. And it took a good... He was in the hospital for several months. And then he came home and rehabbed. And then eventually, you know, he ripped up his knee and he couldn't walk. His balance was fucked.
Yeah.
I mean, it's amazing that he can wipe his own ass and take care, you know, and function.
Yeah.
Because it was so far from that.
Yeah.
It was amazing. The body is amazing. And, you know, they are in hospitals. They know how to do this. They know how to do that. But at a certain point, they're just guessing and trying whatever technical skills they have. But anything beyond that is just, you know, only God knows, as they say.
Yeah, I've been to so many second opinion, third opinion, fourth opinion, spine surgeons, rehabs. And what I've determined is they're all fucking guessing. I've done electrical therapy. I've done so many different. Yeah.
Because I remember I wasn't feeling good. This is years ago. I couldn't quite. You know, when you're playing and you get that second thing, that thing happens like fighters, boxers get it. And then you're like really kicking ass. Like from that there, it's like, oh my God, I'm running out of steam. And then you get that second groove and now it's kicking in.
Yep.
You know what I mean? And I wasn't getting that. And I was walking every day a lot and I just couldn't get my snap on. And I remember my kid was little, then my daughter, the young one, and picking her up to put in the car seat, and I just felt like shit. And my wife is pulling out for work. She said, what is going on with you? I said, nothing. I'm trying to get her. And I didn't know if I'd have a heart attack, you know, like a mild one. And so finally, I went to the hospital. And if you mention heart attack, they take you right in immediately. Mm-hmm. So I said, I don't know if I had a heart attack or I don't feel right. So they took me in and did all these tests, right? And then they go, well, we don't see anything, you know. You may want to look into this, but we don't see anything. And that scared the fuck out of me.
Yeah.
It made me even more paranoid, like something's wrong with me. So I went to the Heart Institute here that's, you know, specialized in heart and all that shit.
Yeah.
And I went there and they gave me a test, a stress test. They hooked all these cords and shit up to my chest and stuff. And then with a main port of like 15 wires, you know, a plug. So they had me walk on a treadmill for like 10 minutes and then the treadmill started going up at an angle, right?
Yeah.
You know, slowly. And after 10 minutes, they said, okay, get off and land. So they immediately put me on a table, plugged this thing in. Okay, well, yeah. Okay, we can fix that. We get up and I'm thinking, fix what?
Mm.
And you know how they are. Well, you have to speak to the doctor. So, okay, I put my shirt on and shit. And I go see the doctor and he says, look, I want you to, here's a script right now. I want you to get some nitroglycerin. And I'm thinking, okay, what the fuck's going on? This is some serious shit.
Yeah.
He said, you've got 95% blockage in one of the main arteries to your heart.
Oh, man.
That's how sick I was. Because, so he said, next week we'll schedule you in for surgery. So, like a dumbass, I had a gig about 2 days later. And singing and playing drums, I was anyways getting, I would get kind of dizzy and then slow the pace down. And then once that went away, and you know, ramp it up again. But I did this fucking gig. I don't know what the fuck I was thinking. And, you know, oh, fuck, I'll die on stage. I must have done 20 minutes. And then I just called. I said, that's it.
Mm-hmm.
And a few days later, I'm in there and they went through my groin area. it cut a hole there and went all the way up into, I had to be awake. You see, you got to be awake for this operation. I mean, you're fucked up out of your mind. They give you that Michael Jackson shit, the shit he died on.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
But give you that, and they give you just enough so you're not, no pain, and you're like semi out of it, but still awake, because you got to be awake. And I'm laying on this table in this room that's like 43 degrees. It's really cold in this room for what reason, I don't know. And there's two big, there's a couple monitors above me, and I'm looking as they're like going through this fucking, see the heart going, and then they're, you know, like douching out this main artery. And I see them doing that, and then they like, this other thing, then they put a fucking stent in me. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And, man, I came back down. They put like a 5-pound weight on you where the incision is. So there's pressure on there so it'll heal, because if it fucking breaks open, you could bleed out.
Yeah,
you know, it's a main artery. But, man, my coloring and everything changed. I wasn't gray anymore. I actually had some color in my face. And, man, it completely changed everything. But my whole point is, if I had been like, listen to the hospital, the people at the hospital, when they said, well, we don't see anything, you may want to look into it. You know that half the people or more, well, they said it was nothing urgent, so I guess it's okay. I probably would have had a stroke, heart attack, or died, you know, like sooner than later. And I'm not, you know, being like dramatic with this, with drama. I mean, 90, 95% blockage in a main artery, that's serious.
Yeah, the percentages
the hospital, they just, you know, they didn't have the shit together. So thank God I looked into it. You know what I mean? And I took it further.
Yeah.
My guy was playing guitar with me. He was on his way to rehearsal this last year, and he didn't feel right. He felt fucked up. And meanwhile, he's not at rehearsal. He's not that kind of guy that would flake out like that. If he wouldn't give me a rehearsal, he'd let me know. So I don't hear from him. And finally, I get a message he's being operated on. He wasn't feeling good. He felt really bad. He went to the fucking doctors, and they took him right in to put a stent in him. He had the same like blockage, and he's not a smoker or any of that shit. And they went through his wrist. You know what I mean? They went through that artery in your wrist.
Yeah.
They went up there and put a stent in him. So it's wild. You're lucky. You know, you're lucky you're where you're at. And I'm sure aspects of it can be frustrating. But like you said, you're teaching, you're playing, right? And you're functioning.
I need to work with the guy you're working with. Every doctor I go to, he's like, you're going to be what you're going to be, which is C6 is my hands and feet are numb, or they feel like sponges. And then I kind of walk with the limp. So, you know, I can play, but when I walk, I can kind of feel the ground. So when I'm playing drums now, where I had that quick twitch stuff with my feet, now it's more like I'm using my hip, I'm using my ass, I'm using other muscles around it, trying to get back to using that quick twitch stuff.
Well, do you have some kind of rehab that you're doing?
Every day, all day long. I'm like, I'm doing everything. And that's another point, like, you know, there's this darkness that comes with a life change like that. And that's why I started the channel. So I'm reaching out to drum heroes who inspired me, because I was self-taught in the 80s.
Yeah.
And so I reach out to these guys and never thinking anything would happen. And then all of a sudden, you know, Martin Chambers accepts from the Pretenders and Chris from Talking Heads. And like, now I have this content and I'm speaking to these heroes and they're helping me out and it's taking me out of this dark place. And I also wanted to shine a light on drummers who I feel were underappreciated in rock and roll history, and you're definitely one of them. Like,
I don't fit. I don't fit, this sounds fucked up, but I always felt years ago like I was a king without a throne, if that makes sense. And it's like, I remember coming back from Berlin after doing Lust for Life.
Yep.
And I know that we made a cool record. I mean, I wasn't thinking, we made a decent record, but here I am back in Hollywood, living in L.A. at the time, and, you know, what's going on in L.A.? Like, bullshit. It was 77, 78, and now what am I going to do? If I had gone, maybe I should have gone to Manchester, England, or Newcastle, or hung out in Europe. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Maybe I would have been more appreciated in Europe. I didn't. I went back to L.A., but it was depressing. And who am I going to play with? I'm not, and God bless him for whatever his bullshit is. I'm not Kenny Aronoff that just gets on there and slams on the drums and plays with anyone and everyone. I've turned down a few gigs that were offered to me over the years.
Sure.
Because, in my life, I've gone out and painted houses and done shit like that rather than play some shitty music I don't believe in. I hate painting and that.
Yeah.
So there's two ways about it. I know I'm there to make money, to take care of the kids and shit and bills, but just playing with, if Dylan called me, okay, or somebody that really has great songs, well, then that's different. But I never got those phone calls. And then having a reputation, my reputation followed me with the, you know, the drug thing, and it scares people. So, you know, where do you go with your, and I'm not this person, so, you know, what would Keith Moon do if he wasn't in The Who? You know what I mean?
Right,
who would he have gone and played drums with? Sure, you know, if you want to look at it with his style.
It's not really going to be a studio session guy.
Well, I mean, I started doing that when I was younger.
Yeah.
I started doing some session stuff, and I remember the first, you know, famous record that sold that I played on was that Todd Rundgren record, Want. Yeah. I'm 15 years old.
Yeah.
And that's like a top 10 record. We got to get you a woman. And I started getting some session calls, you know, but I didn't see the value in it at that age. And I was like, oh, I want to be on the road and the rock and roll bullshit.
Yep.
And believe me, you know, even to Cleveland on a Thursday night, there ain't much going on, believe me, after the gig.
Yeah.
And then I did a succession of years touring with this and that and this and that. But it was only later in life I really appreciate the session thing, and I've done a shitload of sessions throughout the years because I can play really. I'm trained well enough with a click track and put the click on, and then memorizing shit really fast, and then just making it really happen. But that way, you know, I do a session stuff. I'm in my own, you know. By 10 at night, I'm in my own bed. I like that. So, you know, throughout the years, I've done a bunch of session stuff. People don't know about the session stuff I've done with Bootsy Collins, different people I've, jeez, you know, recorded with. But it's a game where, you know, being in with the producers and arrangers, that's how you get to work, you know, besides having a reputation, but it definitely helps being in with different producers that bring you in. And, you know, if they're aware of you, I saw Denzel Washington on TV, and he was talking about hanging out with directors.
Mm.
And he said, I like to work.
Yeah.
And that's what he was saying. That's the way he hangs around with directors and producers, because he likes to work. You like that one? I understand what he's saying. You know what I mean? So, but I didn't play the game. And that's really when there was more of that. There's like one or two guys in LA that they show up and they go, do you want the shit on the computer, or do you want real drums? Do you want both? Or do you want me to make you some samples? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I forget the one guy's name. There's a drummer I know. I don't know if you've met him. His name is Pete Thomas. You know Pete?
Oh, yeah. It's Costello.
Yeah. And he, you know, played a lot of records and with a lot of, I remember, what's it, the band from Australia, they were big for a minute. What were they called? That they wore like black and white outfits.
The Hives.
The Hives. It was either the Hives or something. He mentioned a couple of these bands that he went in, and the producer called them up to. Now I've seen some of these bands; they're decent, but you know how some producers are. They don't want to. If it takes a minute or two to work with a drummer, they don't want to do it. It's like, fuck it, I'll call a pro in, and they'll do it right away, which is kind of fucked up, but that does happen. And like he did Los Lobos, a couple of their records and shit. Because you know the guy that plays drums in Los Lobos, it was like he plays accordion and other instruments, and it was like, okay, when they were putting their shit together, when they were all younger and shit in East L.A., so, okay, who's going to play drums? Okay, I will. You know, one of those bits, like the Beach Boys, okay, who's Dennis, you play drums. Okay, he wasn't a drummer, but he, you know, okay, someone's got to do it.
Well, you're a multi-instrumentalist, too.
Yeah, but Pete was telling me about this one drummer. What's the guy's fucking name? He's in L.A., and he said, this motherfucker gets every session. Whatever sessions there are, he
Josh
gets
Freeze.
Them. Yeah, well, there's Josh, but there's another guy also. What's it says the same name, sounds like the drummer. What's the drummer's name with Pearl Jam? The fuck's his name?
Well, Matt Cameron now, but there was Jack Irons. He was a session guy.
Yeah, Matt. I don't know. It sounded the same name.
Oh, no. Matt Chamberlain. Matt Chamberlain.
Yeah.
He was a session guy.
Whatever. It's whatever. The guy, he was just mentioning this one guy. He said, I'm going to kill him. He gets all the session work. You know, and it ain't like it was. I remember being in Nashville, and there was a couple guys there that were getting all the session work. And I remember this one guy, super nice cat, and a decent drummer. Nothing to go crazy about, but he can play. And he was Keith Urban's guy forever. He was a Keith Urban's band. Yeah. But because he played with Keith Urban, man, everybody wanted him. Maybe some of that mojo would rub off, they're thinking. I don't know. But that fucker would have a day off the road. He'd fly back to Nashville and be doing someone's record. And then the next day fly and meet them in Cincinnati or wherever the fuck they were, you know, touring. And that eventually... Keith got rid of him. The only guy that's been with Keith is the bass player, you know, bald-headed guy who's a really good bass player and a sweet guy, but he's replaced the drummer, so I don't know. I'm sure the guy's doing session stuff. Who knows? It's just so weird out there.
Sounds like you just need an agent.
Yeah, an agent. An agent definitely helps. I mean, I got the drum sound and did a lot of the engineering on the Tin Machine records, okay? And the
you don't need a bio.
It's my doing. And I remember if there were any bands that wanted that sensibility and sound, those would have been good if I had an agent to get me producing work, you know what I mean, to do that.
Yeah.
But I didn't. You know how the business is just weird. Yeah, if I had an agent, I would love somebody that a manager, agent type person.
I think that's all you need. The worst part is like putting together your career bio. Most people don't have that. You've got that. You just need people to like, look, this guy is still around. He's still vital. He still shreds anyone. And you just need to know today's technology. You need to constantly brand yourself. Click, 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 brand yourself, you know, make yourself look famous or whatever. You actually have a Hall of Fame resume.
Yeah, these people go online and do the thing on the computer with teaching and stuff, and it's like, no, thank you.
Yeah.
I do teach a few people that are serious. I've got one guy from Europe that is coming here twice from Europe, and I've taught him, and he gives me reports. Man, it's really happening good. And then this guy from New York, who's a teacher of seventh, eighth grade or something band.
Yep.
I'm a teacher forever, and he's a drummer. He's come in town a few times over the last couple of years and studied for like a week with me. So a few people that are serious. There's this one kid, I've been dealing with him and his father, and they want to come in, and the kid wants to, when this shit that's going on now, killing all of us, if this lightens up or something changes in the next few months, he wants to come from LA and study with me, which is fine.
Sure.
People that are serious, I can teach. And basically I teach people that already have been playing, you know what I mean? Like, teachings, you know, and basically I teach certain techniques and shit that I was taught. So, you know, I can't be bothered with the fucking the computer thing and the camera. It's really got to be hands-on so I can see how someone's sitting and how they're gripping the drumstick and all that shit. Because as you know it, you know, you got people that have never studied with anybody and they're just fine. I mean, they sound great. Mm-hmm. And that's not going to make or break a drummer. But education always fucking helps. I mean, as far as schooling goes, I don't have a thug. I got like an eighth grade education. I quit school at a very young age because I was working, and I fucked that. I spent my time studying, practicing 8 to 10 hours a day, 6 days a week. That's what I did, and studying with Freddie Gruber and then going and jamming at the ghettos in L.A. back in the day. I don't know if it's even like this anymore. There were all these clubs and it's like him and organs with organ trios and shit.
Yeah.
And you can go and jam, you know what I mean, at these places down in Inglewood and shit. So I knew about all these clubs. I was the only white guy. This is the early 70s. And, you know, once, twice a week at night, I'd go down to the ghetto and jam with these guys that were 10, 20, 30 years older than me, playing Jimmy Smith style shit. I stopped playing rock and roll for a while. But I just tried to bring a different sensibility to the game. Because to me, some of the best drumming that I like is the shit on a Jimmy Reed record or an Al Green record, which is all just about a pocket, just about a groove, and has nothing to do with a bunch of crazy ass, you know, bullshit. I mean, I can do some of that. I've got some technique. I can play some, you know, some shit, but the main thing's keeping a groove. And
I love that. I saw one interview and you were talking about, you know, you did your schooling, you did more private instruction, and then you said, well, I wanted to make it, you said you were making it more primitive. I want to go back to primitive. And I think you're the perfect balance between private instruction and just feeling the music and feeling your own DNA.
Well, I remember this. I remember when I go to for my lessons, I'd sit there and listen to the other guy, whoever he was teaching. And these guys, they really had some really nice chops and technique, but I couldn't hear a difference between when they were practicing and or then when and played the drums. It was all very stiff and technical, and that is a thing. I mean, Art Blakey, who luckily I got to see many times, you know, hang out a little bit with him, see his gigs when he was in L.A. and Chicago, different places I'd be playing, I'd go and see him. And perfect example of someone that kept primitive shit like a motherfucker, but then, you know, had some chops and other shit going on. But that primitive thing, it's like these guys, Vinny Caliuta and this one and that one, they got some fantastic fucking chops and ability, but I do not hear the primitive shit. I just don't. That's been fucking beaten out of it.
Those guys were all the rage when I was growing up. Weckl, Caliuta, Chad Wackerman. And I was like, yeah, I'd watch the videos and I was like, yeah, absolutely. I don't know if I'll ever be able to do that. But then when I went and saw U2 live and Larry Mullen is just pounding the shit out of the drums, or like Alan White, those 80s records, or you know, Adam and the Ants, Bow Wow Wow, all these new wave bands that are really tribal. I was like, that, I'm feeling that in my heart. Like, I don't care if they can't do the perfect double strokes or whatever. Like, the energy's coming off the stage.
There's just something about the primitive thing with some of these. It's like, what's his name? I went and saw him do a clinic. I got to know him a little bit, Terry Bozzio.
Yep.
I went and saw him do some clinic down in Santa Monica. It was an outdoor little stage thing down in Santa Monica. And I remember pulling up there and parking, and he's in the middle of it and watching him. And he's doing, with his left hand, he's doing these fucking 64th notes. And with the right hand, he's doing 32nd notes. And then with his feet, he's doing triplets. And I'm just like, fuck. It blew my mind.
All these ostinato patterns. Like every limb is doing a different meter, a different speed.
But then I saw this video. There's this video when I was over in Switzerland. I was over there recording and something, and then a video, I don't know who had it, of Mick Jagger went out and did like three or four gigs. Like there was in 88, 89, there was some stock market fuck up, and I think Mick Jagger lost $10 million, or I don't know what he lost, some money. So he went out to do some gigs to make some money. And one of them was in Japan. One or two were in Japan. One was in Australia. I mean, in really fucking places, you know, really out there.
Yeah.
So Japan, Australia, and somewhere else. It was like three or four gigs. He probably was making $5 million a gig. You know, like a, he had Satriani on guitar. He had, I forget the other guitar player, and he had Terry Bozzio with him. And they're doing Jumpin' Jack Flash, and they come to the turnaround, Jumpin' Jack Flash, here's the gas, gas, gas. And he goes, blugga-da, blugga-da, blugga-da. And I'm going, no.
Yeah. Lead drummer.
About Charlie Watts' retarded drum rolls that just sound good. You know what I mean? They're just
definitely not playing to the song. It's, you need a spotlight.
Yeah.
You need a spotlight.
So I know that Terry Bozzio had that gig for a while with Korn, and I don't know any of it. I don't have any inside information on it. None of which people are friends of mine, but I get the picture, and I could be wrong, but here's what I'm thinking. At some point they said, we don't really need this. Do we really need this kind of shit going on in our songs? You know, when Terry Bozzio had the offer, and then the other guy came back, or whatever happened. You know what I mean? Someone else, or the original guy came back.
I saw a couple rehearsal videos. And it was just a bit odd. And don't get me wrong, I'm the biggest Bozzio fan in the world for what I've stolen from him. But that was never really a blend for me.
Yeah, it's just I don't, you know, I mean, it's just, and believe me, when I was younger, I didn't understand. I mean, I just was like, fucking Buddy Rich and Louis Belson and these guys have this fantastic technique. But Buddy Rich could be funkier than anybody as far as, he could do everything. That motherfucker could do it all. So I don't. Yeah, you mentioned I did a drum clinic up in Frisco back in the day, and it was with fucking everybody. It was for Remo and Zildjian, right?
Yeah.
And then John Robinson and this one and Benny and everybody. And there I am, and they're all looking at my drum set because I got my drum set with the big kick and one rack tom and one or two floors and. They're all looking at it like, what the fuck is this? They all have the Yamaha and the thing and the Tama. And I did the clinic. I brought a couple guys that I'd been playing with. I produced this record for Jack Grish from TSOL.
Mm-hmm.
And I was playing with Jack I produced a record for Triple X, the inside project called Tender Fury. And with Randy. And Randy now has been with Pennywise for a while, the bass player, bass player.
Yeah.
And Randy Bradbury and the guitar player who's, I don't know if he's with the Vandals or whatever, I forget his name. But I brought them and I just wanted to show the audience like applying drumming with music. And so we played a couple, songs minus the singing and I talked to the audience, but I swear when I was backstage from one drummer to another, they could not tell the difference between one of these drummers and there was a bunch of known motherfuckers.
Yeah.
That all the drums sounded the same.
Yeah.
They all sounded the same playing, the same kind of sensibility and shit. And they all just sounded the fucking same. You know what I mean? So
it's interesting. Yeah, I endorse Mapex and I love it and I love you Mapex family for sure. And they're all so highly skilled. They put out the videos that are announcing the new drums and stuff like that.
Right.
I just come from a different angle and I went out to this Mapex summit last year in Nashville and wow, you sit back in awe and they're just amazing, but they do tend to blend together once you've heard four solos in a row.
And who who do they have as far as their endorsees? Like who are the known guys that Mapex has?
A lot of top R&B like and hip hop like John Legend and J. Cole and there's a lot of newer metal bands that are really popular that they have.
Yeah.
I'd have to just like look at the Mapex roster to see everyone's okay. A players for sure.
Yeah, where do they make their shit, Mapex? Is it made out of the country, or is it made where do they make their drums and shit?
I think their hub is actually in Nashville.
Oh, is it?
Yeah,
they manufacture in Nashville.
Pretty sure. I mean, they're definitely international. They check in. I have to check into all their Facebook pages and stuff. But that's where everyone had to fly into to show off the new equipment, and they had a studio over there.
Yeah, how long have you been with Mapex?
Since I've been with Duff, so 2010. Yeah.
And Duff, he lives primarily in Seattle?
Yeah, Seattle and L.A. Yep, back and forth.
But he spend more time in Seattle most of the time?
Yeah. Yeah, he's got
more.
Very smart guy. Went to school for business during the Guns N' Roses days, and he's raising two really sharp daughters, and one's going to want to be a rock and roller, and the other one's going to be a model, of course.
But he's smart. Why would he fucking want to be in L.A.? He can live anywhere he wants. He's smart for being in Seattle. It's nice there.
Yeah. It's not now. We're at 20 days of rain now, so I can move on from that. Hey, if you don't mind, I've got these specific, I'm a tin machine guy, and I've got these specific questions, and I don't want to burn you out, so I might try to roll through these if you don't mind.
No, let's do it.
Want to say, I love how you said the king without a throne thing, because when I've seen you in rehearsals and I've seen you on stage and your confidence on stage, you do seem to have this alpha quality about you, this band leader quality about you, which I think probably comes from your big band influence with those drummers.
Well, you got drummers that are either keeping a beat, they're just kind of plodding along, and then you get the drummers that, they set the fucking groove. And a perfect example is I remember watching the Jerry Lewis Telethon, and they were into like hour 18 or whatever, or 16. I mean, it was like 4 a.m, and the band was fucking fried. You could tell. And Buddy Rich comes on. Now all of a sudden, the band sounds completely different.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, you know what I mean? And one of my favorite drummers, this black guy, and I saw him do a clinic back in the 60s. Shit, I got to get my brain working. Black drummer, he played with Count Basie. He played with Count Basie on and off. Jesus Christ.
Here, pull it up.
I'm trying to think of his name.
Sonny Payne?
Minute. Say what?
Sonny Payne?
That's it.
Sonny Payne.
Sonny Payne is a perfect example. See, I don't hear drummers, some rock and roll drummers. There are some, but they take the thing and they pull it and push it and pull it back and then push it forward and really get a thing going. You know what I'm saying? Like Sonny Payne and or Dino Danelli back in the day, with the Rascals.
Yeah.
And then you get these guys that are just kind of plodding along and not really adding, they're keeping a beat. And I can see why drum machines took over, because the time is good. The time is perfect.
Sure.
So there's just a thing with music out here with fucking bass player, drummer, whatever, that you can bring to this show, you can bring to the fucking gig and really make it, mold it, and push it and pull it and do what needs to be done. Or you've got the other groove of just someone plodding along and they don't really get it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, you
seem to be more of a music director. Like, you're not shy. You keep it light. You have a sense of humor. But you're serious about your
humor
music.
It's really a mainstay. But it's just, you either got drummers that are really making shit happen, and I don't mean because of a bunch of fancy chops, just the groove. They're pulling the thing. They're really pulling the shit together. and making it, or, you know, you've played with enough people where you're playing with a bass player and they're not even listening to you. You know, you're not playing together.
Yeah.
And so in rock and roll. So, I mean, I probably, part of my education with music, you know, was setting me up to play jazz and stuff, though I got bored of that. So I'm a product of rock and roll, you know, not, you know, I wasn't even born. I don't want to do recreation. You get these people at 52nd Street or whatever, you know, it's like bebop or whatever the fuck they're playing. And that I'm a product of, you know, I grew up in the 60s and,
yeah.
And so I tried to bring some sensibility of a Sonny Payne and jazz, you know, shit to rock and roll.
Mm-hmm.
As far as, like I said, like listening and pushing and pulling the music, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I don't know if that answers anything.
Absolutely. I'm going to take a little left turn here. I've seen another interview, and you don't have to answer any personal stuff that you don't want to. That's just fine.
But yeah.
It seems that I went through a couple divorces around the same time that when you were young, you went through a divorce.
Yeah.
And my mom was also a model. So I would, uh-huh. I would travel with her quite a bit, and I got very comfortable living in hotels. Doing homework in hotels or just going from city to city. And I was wondering, were you still, I mean, you started so young, you had a record deal at 11. I played my first pro show at 14 and I thought that was cool, but you had a record deal at 11. So when all this family stress was going on, did it affect you in any way? Were you still practicing? Were you still gigging?
Yeah. I mean, my father left when I was like 12. Okay.
Yeah.
12, and he split. And my mom, their problems and shit, and my dad not being around.
Yep.
And it was time to grow up. And, you know, it's like, and I was very lucky in the fact that I saw that mom and dad, besides being mom and dad, they were just people. Mm-hmm. I was able to see them as people, okay,
yeah.
Despite them being mom and dad. And that they were just people, and being people, they had their problems. You know what I'm saying?
Sure.
So as best as I could, but I mean, I was, you know, emotionally and all that, it was time to grow up. And most people don't have to do that at 11, 12 years old.
Yeah.
Now, you know what I mean? And I was off and running, and dad wasn't around, and mom wasn't emotionally available. So, you know, I'm hanging out at clubs at 14 and 15 and, you know, hanging out with Jimi Hendrix. And, you know, I look over there and there's Stevie Winwood and this one and that one and Janis Joplin, and living at the Chelsea Hotel at 15, 16. So I was in an adult world and I was a child.
Yep.
Seriously, 15, 14-year-old child.
Yep.
But I was already off into it. And dealing with all the bullshit that there is. You know, I didn't get into this thing, okay, I'm going to make money. And I had to learn how to make a buck or two out of this game, you know, the music world.
Sure.
And it took quite a while. And the marriage thing, yeah, I've been married 3 times. I'm on my third wife, I think, hopefully my last. But, you know, maybe always looking for something that you know, coming from a broken home.
But you and your brother maybe got tighter as you were playing music together.
Yep. Yep. We worked together all the time. And,
you know, he's a great storyteller. You both are really good storytellers. And the stories are basically similar. They're just coming from a different, maybe there's a different detail here and there. And I was blown away that when you guys were jamming at some point during that time, maybe it was a little later, you were jamming in Burgess Meredith's house with his son.
Yeah. Yeah. John Meredith. Let me get rid of this call. Whoever the fuck this is.
Sure.
Thank you. Are you there?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm trying to think. We would go, John Meredith, Burgess, they had a house in Suffern County, you know, outside of New York. And we would go out there for the weekend and jam, you know, rehearse and stuff, or vice versa. He would come down and hang out with us in the city and rehearse. We had this duplex, we had this townhouse for a while that we had. And on the top floor, we had our gear set up, and we would rehearse there. You know, I remember my first gigs at 10 and 11 would be playing these house parties, you know, carrying my drums up four flights of stairs and playing at some party or some bullshit. So we actually started doing gigs, promotion gigs for Roulette Records. Mm-hmm. We would go out and do these gigs out in Paramus, New Jersey or wherever, and there'd be like 6, 8, 10 acts on the bill, and we'd come out there and lip sync, which I thought was the strangest fucking thing. Okay, we're here. Okay, you guys are going to lip sync. And it's like, well, there's an audience out there. So we put the record on and just lip sync. So there I am pretending to play the drums to a to a record. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's nuts.
Welcome to show business. But, yeah, we had something in common with John Meredith, his dad being Burgess Meredith, a fucking great actor.
Yeah. But he, I heard he had a little stage inside his house. He would maybe rehearse there.
Yeah, he had a little stage. We had a little stage area where we'd set up and play. And just, you know, play our Dylan songs and Beatles songs and whatever else. You know what I mean? We'd play.
Yeah.
And I remember Roulette, we got assigned two songs. Really, Cheeseball, When the Party's Over, and Summertime or some bullshit was the other. But I remember we had these producers that were freaks, these guys, Hugo and Luigi. And if you look at their resume, man, Sam Cooke and fucking tons of badass shit they did.
Yeah.
We got them a little later in life. But I remember having a ghost, a guitar player, Vinnie Bell. He was a session guy. They'd bring him in to add guitar on the tracks, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Or have a ghost singer singing along with my brother, you know what I mean? Kind of mix it in the background. And Roulette was interesting, to say the least, that label. I mean, we're talking definitely criminal. Sleazy, you know, running that whole thing. You know, he had this like 2 or 3 story office, and on one floor, he had about six studios, right?
Yeah.
And from what I heard is he had them all bugged up to his office so he could push a button and listen to what's going on in each studio. You like that one? I guess he wanted enough people were talking about him.
Oh, God.
But, yeah. You know, there's the old days. You know, labels are. They're basically all crooks.
Yeah.
But, you know, he'd have, like, him and other labels, they'd have like 4 pressing plants and they'd account for 3 of them or 2 of them, and the other ones they wouldn't. That would just be side money that the artists wouldn't know about. You know what I mean? So
right. The
artists, oh, you sold 50,000 units. Meanwhile, they sold 150,000 units and they're not getting an accounting on the 100,000. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Units. Meanwhile, you know, meanwhile, some of the bands have to share a dressing room with a horse, right?
Yes, the diving horse.
The diving horse.
It's in Atlantic City. Yeah, playing a 4-day, 5-day thing in Atlantic City at Steel Pier with my dad was headlining. And on that bill was the Animals, their burden. It was their last contractual gig. And they fucking hated each other. They were like fighting and shit.
Yeah.
And you know, Chaz Chandler and all of them. And I guess that was the point when they split up. I guess Chaz Chandler was in New York, and that's when he stumbled on Hendrix. Now, I first saw Jimi Hendrix on one of my dad's shows. My dad had a 4 or 5 day run at the old Paramount Theater in New York City. And Little Richard was on the bill.
Yep. And Hendrix was playing guitar, and I didn't know who this guy was, but he stuck out. I went like, who the fuck's this guitar player? He's fucking badass. And then a couple of years later, I got to know Jimi Hendrix a little bit, to the point where I'd run into him certain places. And I remember he invited me down to see him record, and he was working on his second record, you know. And I went and saw him record a little bit of that over at the record plant, you know. What a nice guy he was. What a sweet, sweet, nice man, you know.
Seems
it's really
like it.
Cool. Super cool.
All right, I'm going to jump a couple hurdles here and go forward to Tin Machine. I like how the band started, and you were trying to get back to your roots and what all the four of you loved, like the Yardbirds. But it seemed to me, for some reason, I gravitated to the second record. I don't know why. I think the first record was great. The second record to me, and I'm probably wrong, but it just seemed more modern. And I don't know, it's different elements. There's some spooky elements, like You Belong to Rock and Roll. And just the intro, the intro to Universal... or Baby Universal, I probably stole three elements out of that to create three completely different songs when I was, you know, learning to record and stuff like that. So was that a conscious effort to just expand on your influences to make it sound different than the first record? Or did that just come out naturally?
No, not necessarily. It was like, here we are doing the second record. And of course, with time, you're playing more together. You know, okay, now we got 500 hours we've played together, and you're at a different place. You know what I mean? Like with any band.
Sure.
You know what I'm saying? But there was no, let's do this. We're going to do it. Just, it was an organic thing of just, you know, evolving or whatever. The second record did not do well compared to the first record. The second record did about 220,000 copies. Now, right now, that would be considered awesome.
Yeah.
But back then, compared to the first one, which, you know, went gold in a lot of areas around the world really fast, you know what I mean? But the second one, it did not. And I think there was some confusion because we did not do a decent tour. We did the first record. We were supposed to do Europe and America and do a proper tour. Yeah. And meanwhile, okay, you're only doing 8 gigs. David's going to go. He's been offered $50 million to do a farewell tour. So we stopped Tin Machine for him to do that. And it confused people, I think. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Stopping. I mean, if we had toured by that first record, I don't know, we could have jacked up sales probably more and cemented the thing more. I wasn't too happy about, okay, you're not going to do anything now. David's going out making $50 million, so you're just going to fucking wait or do whatever the fuck you have to do. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So there was some business and some decisions that were really fucked up. And it's like, wow, what happened to the tour we were supposed to do? You know what I mean? What am I going to argue with someone who got offered $50 million? But at that point, you work with certain people that have so much money and they just lose sight of shit.
Yeah.
Now, I believe the Tin Machine, as far as the whole thing, grounded David and got him back to his roots.
Yeah.
And a reason to do something, because he's making a lot of records that were kind of dance records, kind of like not good, shit. And I think he was capable of doing a lot better. But, you know, after he started, you know, after the Let's Dance and stuff, which is a great record, and playing, you know, he peaked at playing Dodger Stadium and shit, you know, when he got to that point.
Yeah, and after the Billie Jean record, it the material kind of went down a little bit for me, too.
Yeah, and then I remember talking to him once about his records. Yeah, we did that in 2 weeks. He'd go in and make these records really fast and get some guy, yeah, he's a multi-instrumentalist, I hire him and get this guy and go in and do these records real fast, and something's going to suffer.
Yeah.
And then it becomes about the money see, this, it was the closest we could get to the Machine. It's like, yeah, the lead singer of the band did have, you know, $100 million. That is definitely, yeah. And, but we had a budget to be, we wrote those records. A lot of them, I'd come in, we'd come in with ideas, David and Reeves, or my brother and me, or...
Yeah.
And then a lot of times, shit was just written in the studio. Mm-hmm. We would just write in the studio, you know what I mean? Which was very cool to be able to do that, just to sit there and, okay, here's an idea. And it was really...
I'm sure you were never short of ideas with that much talent in the room. Yeah.
There's a shitload of tracks sitting in vaults from those albums. There's got to be 50 tracks. We would do 30, 40 songs to be to pull 12 or however many on those records. I mean, there's a ton of shit sitting, you know, tracks that were not used, a ton of instrumentals, some crazy shit that's just sitting around. So, you know, there were people... The booking agency, you know, the big booking company that does everybody, what are they called?
CAA?
No, they're fucking concert promoters. What are they called? The real big one. They do everyone. Jack White, everybody. Shit. Like, they've taken over all the venues. Like, basically, any venue that's 500 seater or a little bit more, they have all the way up to festivals. Whatever that concert promotion company is called.
Yeah.
And they had David.
Live Nation.
Live Nation. Okay. Yeah. They were called something else back then. And they had Bowie. They did not like us doing 1,000, 2,000 seaters. There's no money to make. Mm-hmm. They wanted to see David doing David Bowie shit and playing 15,000, 20,000 seaters. You did?
Yeah.
So they weren't, a lot of people weren't happy about it. Meanwhile, we're having fun and he's having fun. But you got all these fractions of people around you. Hey, you shouldn't be doing this and da da da. And I remember telling David, are you going to end up like Frankie Valli, motherfucker? You're sat there playing your hits. And rather than making some really good shit. And he was capable of so much. What a great artist, very talented guy. And I thought he did a lot of stuff that was beneath him. You know what I mean?
That's too bad. I definitely think the band, you know, was cut short. I mean, whose idea was the LAX show? Do you think the LAX, I felt that was like your launch show for what was to come next. It was so different.
Yeah, I mean, look, we had another record scheduled to do, and then the plug got pulled. And I saw somewhere it was blamed on me. It's a bunch of bullshit. I showed up on every gig. I did my work. Yeah. You know what I mean? Despite whatever problems I had. And like I said, you had people that... You had also an audience that was mixed. Half of the audience, a lot of... His audience, they liked Tin Machine, and then the other part of his audience, what are you doing with these fucking cousins? You know, you're David Bowie. You don't need these people. Fuck them. And, yeah, he did need us because it kept it grounded. I didn't, you know, like, he'd ask me, what do you think of this idea? I said, I don't think much of it. It sucks. And I would be honest with him.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? I wasn't there to kiss ass.
Yeah.
I mean, it could be a very sweet, really beautiful person, you know, but you get to that size, you got a lot of people just fucking telling you what you want to hear. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
Sure, Duff could tell you a million fucking stories like this. The Guns N' Roses and the thing, and you know, you don't want to do your own thing, and Duff has his own thing in his own right. He's a singer-songwriter, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
He's good. But you got people, well, you're okay, but you really should be with Axl, and, you know, right?
I've been a witness to conversations, you know, they said it would never happen, you know, when hell freezes over, there's no money that's big enough. I've heard those phone conversations in a room before, and then it happened.
Exactly. So, you know, that like I was saying a while back about him living in where he lives. He doesn't just live in L.A. Smart.
Yep.
That he's got a life.
Yeah.
And it's not just in L.A. Fuck L.A. is fucking fuck L.A. I mean, it's got nice people out there, I know, and there's some nice things about it. But it ain't the L.A. I know from years ago. It's completely changed. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Like a lot of stuff. But
that's why I had to get out of there originally. I mean, I grew up down there, but it came to a point where I just needed something completely different, and that's why I ended up
exactly.
in Seattle.
Exactly. And you left and didn't look back, right?
No, pretty much not, yeah. And now everyone's dead, so I don't have any family members to go back to.
I hear you. Well, that happens. The older you get, everybody dies, starts dying off, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then you're an orphan.